Welcome, everybody. This is session 211 on breaking encryption. The title is An Increasingly Heated But Static Debate with No End or Resolution in Sight. Where should or must it go next? It is at the center of one of the most complex and controversial debates in the history of the global telecoms and technology industries. And our goal is to stimulate a debate that moves to practical principles and ideas that can be deployed in this space. My name is Jens Jeppesen. I'm with the Center for Democracy and Technology. I'll moderate the panel. We have had another encryption-focused debate yesterday. We had a review of state of play in a number of different countries. So we heard about US legislative battles on encryption being settled back in the 90s, but coming back time and time again. So parts of the law enforcement community will raise the demand for some kind of backdoor access to encrypted communication, some way of undermining encrypted communications. And we heard about politicians in places like Brazil taking these sort of simplistic ideas and saying to tech companies in their environment, well, if you're doing it in the US, surely you can do it for us. In Europe, very mixed picture. New law in the UK gives quite broad powers for removal of electronic protection. I think it's not quite clear what that exactly will mean. We have some very balanced and reasonable statements coming out of ENISA, the European Network and Information Security Agency, as well as Europol, the police agency, where they say solutions that intentionally weaken technical protection mechanisms to support law enforcement will intrinsically weaken the protection against criminals as well, which makes an easy solution impossible. But at the same time, we have ministers from time to time calling for ill-defined but dramatic action, and often in the form of legislation. So we had the UK and French ministers recently telling the Commission to come up with legislation by October of this year. To its credit, the Commission is not going to do that, but what it will do is set in motion a reflection process to work out legal, technical, policy aspects of this whole issue and put policy options in front of ministers by the end of this year. And so one very practical thing that we can, a practical public service we can provide today is giving our best input on the legal, technical, and policy aspects. And we are well equipped and well staffed to do that because we have some very capable speakers with us today. We have Saikat Datta from CIS. He replaces his colleague Vishuddha Mada, who was supposed to be here. We're grateful you could make it. We have Amy Stepanovic from Access Now, who is a very well-known advocate in this area, has talked about these issues many times. We have Bart Prinnell from the Catholic University of Leuven, a technologist with deep expertise in the area. And we have Matt Peacock, Group Corporate Affairs Director from Vodafone, and also the organizer of the panel. So thanks very much for doing that. So let's start. We begin with a few short remarks, 3 to 4 minutes each, and then we take a round of questions and comments. So let's begin with Bart. Will you give us an input from the technical side, please?
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. So I'm the techie in the room. So I've been in this business for almost 30 years. And when I started, crypto was very expensive and very rare. And you would think today we have a major success because there is about 30 billion devices with cryptography today. But if you start looking at which of those devices protect user data and which protect company data against users, in fact, only 12 billion actually do protect user data. And of those, half are our mobile phones, which encrypt our data until we end up in the fixed network, and then everything is decrypted and sent ready for interception over the fixed network. So if you then look at the 6 billion left, about half of this is HTTPS. It's growing, this is very good, but most of it can be intercepted with middle attacks because there was a very big governance problem that you can attack browsers or that governments have been corrupting CAs. And so what we left is a couple of billion applications. WhatsApp is one of them, iMessage, and then Skype. We know with high certainty that Skype has been subverted by the US government. For WhatsApp and iMessage, the situation is a bit better, although they tend to take backups of the messages in the clear in things like iCloud. So it's not even clear we are there. And of course, they also don't hide metadata, which means who's talking to whom. So the bottom line is there is massive encryption, but there is no mass solution that gives secure end-to-end encryption that protects metadata. So as a crypto community, I think we failed our users. But of course, it's not only our fault. I think there is also political and economical factors there. So in spite of this, the fact that actually I would say the crypto guys apparently have won, we actually lost. In spite of this, law enforcement keeps saying that they're going dark. And especially like in the last 18 months after every terrorist attack in Europe, there is public statements of public officials saying that encryption was part of the reason why they could not stop the attack. And none of these claims have been substantiated as far as I understand. And then what politicians want, they want a miracle solution where only they will be able to access or break the encryption and nobody else will. And cryptographers have been saying already from the 90s, such a solution does not exist. It's not technically feasible. If there is such a golden key or backdoor or whatever you want to call it, first, who you're gonna give it to? Because many will come and ask for it. And second, it will actually be found also by other parties who don't want them to find it, organized crime, other nations. So I think the only solution there is in practice is circumvent the end systems with malware. But of course, that has also problems because then this will proliferate and be also abused. So I think we'll have to accept, I think, that there is more and more crypto, but hopefully we can get it right in the future, that's one thing. And I think for the law enforcement or terrorism protection or national intelligence, we have to rely more on metadata because I think we're still very, very far from protecting any metadata in an adequate way. There is no large-scale application that does this. Thank you.
Three quick points on the overall position and then just a little bit of perspective on Vodafone and our views. So look, the first thing is, let's be clear, that the global economy cannot operate without secure end-to-end encryption. Nobody will move money around the world if they are worried that there'll be uncontrolled third-party access to that traffic. Also, as many of you, all of you in this room know, encryption plays a really critical role in freedom of expression and giving people the confidence that they can exercise their right to freedom of expression. So for the avoidance of doubt, end-to-end encryption plays a vital role in keeping people safe, businesses safe, the economy functioning, and making the modern world work. However, at the same time, there's another dimension to this. And the other dimension is that there is, as Bart's just said, growing and widespread political and public concern that end-to-end encrypted communications are being used by terrorists and criminals and others who wish to do harm. And I would also say in parallel with that, in a growing number of countries, there's a sense that somehow technology companies are out of step with the popular mood on this. The fear that those people express and that the politicians are responding to is that the technology that keeps us safe helps protect the people who want to do us harm. Now, please do not underestimate that sentiment, and do not underestimate the potential for that sentiment to translate into a whole bunch of unintended consequences, including, for example, our network being awash with malware we have no control over. I'd also say, I'm not saying that anyone in this room would do that, but please don't dismiss those public concerns as somehow illegitimate or entirely misplaced. They are heartfelt and they are real. Yeah. Third point. So when I suggested to Brett and the Fabulous Access Now team months ago that we hold this debate on encryption, I did so because in my view, and I'm sure many others in the room feel the same way, What happens to encryption over the next 3 to 5 years will determine the fate of global digital human rights for the next 20 to 30 years in every aspect. This is the debate at the center of RightsCon, in my view. And at the moment, we're heading potentially towards an impossibly binary debate, where on the one side, the citizen's absolute right to privacy is central, and on the other side, and seemingly potentially presented in conflict with that, the citizen's right to be kept free from harm is absolutely central. And that's a false argument. It's a false argument. The reality is people want, need, and deserve both in equal measure. We know that. But unfortunately, where we're getting to in the debate now is that simply restating the positions at either end of the polls, as it were, privacy versus freedom from harm, is not going to resolve this. And we have in this room and in this RightsCon and in other places, you know, the finest minds with the best intentions to keep people safe and to protect the things that we hold dear. And we're all of us going to have to work together to find a way through this. I have no idea what that solution is. I absolutely agree with everything that Bart has said. But we're going to need to work together to find a way through it. Briefly, a few points on Vodafone's perspective and a couple of interesting facts I want to share with you that we've not disclosed before that will help inform the debate. Okay, the first thing, just so we're clear. Our customers' private data is sacrosanct. Protecting that data is the most important thing you learn the day you join the company. It is the sine qua non above everything else. And if we lose our customers' trust, we lose our business. Secondly, the integrity of our network is everything to us. We are very strongly opposed to any actions from any actor that happen without our knowledge and without our control on our network that have the effect of weakening the integrity of that network. Thirdly, and for those of you, I'm sure you all know this, but it's really important to remember that we operate under licenses given to us by governments that require us to comply with local law. And there can sometimes be a tension between our publicly stated principles and what local law tells us we have to do. We manage those tensions as best we can. It is not easy. And one of the factors we always have to take into account is that we have thousands of employees on the ground in many cases, difficult countries, some of whose liberty and livelihoods would be put at risk if we do not comply with the law. Finally, two quick facts to share with you. In a few weeks' time, we'll be publishing the latest version of our Law Enforcement Transparency Report, which I'm sure many of you in the room have read previous versions of it. Two very interesting things in that, which I'll share with you now. The first is that we've concluded an analysis, country by country, across 28 countries, of the state of law in each of those countries on encryption. It's the first time any such analysis has been published, and possibly first time it's ever been undertaken. And it's really sobering reading, because pretty much everywhere, the law has not kept pace with the technology, and it is far from clear that a licensed telecoms operator like Vodafone can lawfully carry secure end-to-end encrypted traffic where we do not have the key. Second little factoid for you, which will also be in the transparency report in a few weeks' time, we passed a very important milestone about a year ago, and we didn't realize we passed it at the time, but we only found out quite recently, and that is that in January 2016, looking at all mobile data traffic that we carry worldwide, more than 50% of that traffic is now HTTPS. Encrypted traffic, okay? January 2016. And a proportion of that traffic, what proportion we don't know, will be secure end-to-end encrypted where we do not hold the key. It's a very, very important milestone. So you put those two little factoids together, what it means is that we have an absence of legal certainty and an absence of transparency on a very, very significant issue across our networks.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you, Matt.
Thank you. And I see some familiar faces out there, so I apologize to those of you who have to listen to me yammer on about this again. I see some new ones. Thank you all for coming. Thanks to the people watching on the live stream, Vodafone for hosting this panel, and for everybody up here on stage with me. I joined Access Now several years ago, and legitimately from the first day I was at Access Now, I've been talking with and for the organization about encryption. Because I walked in that first day, and we were still talking about the revelations under Edward Snowden, and I said, if we don't start moving the bar on encryption and start talking about what minimum protections need to be provided to people, we are actually helping governments conduct mass surveillance. Because the more plain text traffic that circuits around the web and the more that's available to intelligence agencies, the more they are going to force their way to having access to that data. The result of those conversations was a website we call encryptallthethings.net, which we thought put forward some steps that could provide minimum levels of security for people. And the reason we did that is really because we think that encryption is one of the several things that lay at the heart of the protection of human rights around the world. We think that encryption is at the heart of, for example, privacy and freedom of expression. That point of view was supported by a 2015 report by the UN Special Rapporteur, David Kaye, for freedom of expression, who is at this conference with us all this week. In that report, he talked about how encryption, as well as tools that support anonymity, actually allow people to exercise both of those rights, freedom of expression and privacy. It's also very interesting because I know Vodafone is on the GNI principles, so whereas the UN Special Rapporteur's report talks about encryption and security allowing the exercise of privacy, the GNI principles actually talk about privacy protecting or facilitating security. And it is this positive feedback loop, I think, that you can see in these two things, where instead of what you typically hear people talk about, which is this balancing test where you have privacy on one side and encryption or security on the other side, which is quite interesting because a balance is actually achieved when you either add or subtract from both sides of a thing. What they really are talking about is more of a zero-sum game where you have to take something from either privacy or security to give to the other side. We also think that encryption is at the heart of the right to data protection, which is not something that we talk about in the United States very much, but here in Europe, it is very much something that is considered a right, and to have your data encrypted is not going to provide this panacea solution against unauthorized access, but it is a very necessary part of that puzzle toward protecting users and user information from bad parties. I just want to talk about two other ways that I think encryption implicates rights that might not be as obvious. The first is that when you have conversations about encryption in any jurisdiction, in any place in the entire world, those conversations are echoed in other places, and they're often echoed without some of the nuance. And so, for example, the conversation that we have had in the United States, not only over the last few years, but since the 1970s, this is how long we have been fighting with one another about whether or not encryption is essential or needing to be undermined, that conversation has filtered down into a lot of other places where they now assume that the US can bypass all encryption, that the US government gets access to everything, and they are forcing through and pushing through laws that could allow them to have that same access, which is absolutely incorrect, by the way, if anybody in this room also holds that point of view. The US government doesn't have that kind of access. We have fought very, very hard. Several people in this room I know have fought hard to prevent the US from passing a law that would provide them with that type of access. But it's really important to provide that education, that level of nuance to these conversations all over the world. The other piece of this is that what we've seen and what I'm sure Vodafone's report will continue to show is that countries don't have a single solution that they are putting forward to, quote unquote, the encryption problem. They have lots of different solutions. And every different solution means that these global companies, because internet companies are global companies naturally, because the internet is a global medium, knock on wood, it will stay that way. So they are being asked to build in several vulnerabilities in order to comply with all of these different laws and all of these different mandates and requirements. Now, very wealthy, very established companies might be able to build a product with only one vulnerability and serve it to only one jurisdiction. And then serve another product with another vulnerability to one jurisdiction, and then serve a very secure product to a place with no mandates. And that way they have three products that they have to update, they have to maintain, they have to service, they have to protect to the best extent possible, while also protecting the vulnerabilities. Less well-off companies are not going to be able to do that. They are going to have to incorporate every single vulnerability for every single jurisdiction they serve, which means they're going to have very insecure products that are not going to be able to compete, which means users are going to have less choice, less options, and really kind of hurt across the market of being able to have secure access to tools and technologies that I think everybody in this room deserves to have access to and deserves to have access to with the guaranteed protection of their human rights. So I'm very much looking forward to the rest of this conversation, and thank you.
Thank you, Amy. And Saikat, over to you.
So 7 years ago, I'm essentially a journalist. I've been a journalist. It's hardwired into my head, so I may have different designations, but I'm essentially a journalist. And the whole encryption debate arrived in a very strange manner 7 or 8 years ago when I found three gentlemen following me around. And it turned out to be they were from the intelligence community in India. And the reason they were following me around was because I was investigating a story on corruption in the intelligence agency. And so once I printed the story, they didn't send back a rebuttal, they sent three men after me. And over a couple of days, and I caught them the second day, and I handed them over to the cops. And suddenly they got so scared that we might beat them up, they quickly fished out their ID cards and mentioned that we are from this agency and we are intelligence guys. And that's the first thing you realize when something like that happens to you is, now you are under suspicion even though you have made the complaint. So suddenly, the balance of power changes completely. And that's very difficult to explain to people. The need for encryption is to ensure that the principle of justice, which is innocent until proven guilty, is maintained, because otherwise everybody is under suspicion and you're constantly trying to prove that you're innocent and you are presumed guilt. So now let me give you a slight idea of the regulatory landscape in India as far as encryption is concerned. One, I am yet to hear a politician ever talk about encryption. It's not even an issue. So that space has been completely ceded to the bureaucracy. And this is what the bureaucracy has gifted us. It's basically it falls between two books. One book would be Kafka's Trial, and the other book would be Joseph Heller's Catch-22. And it falls somewhere right in between, and let me explain to you how. So the telecom ministry says that telecom companies cannot have more than 40-bit encryption. But in the same law, because they don't have the ability to crack anything higher than that, so we need to look at whenever we need to look at it, so it can't be more than 40-bit. But the same law also tells them that if there is a breach in your network, we'll come after you. So the guy's like, you say 40-bit on one side, and then you say any breach and it's my responsibility, what am I supposed to do? Now it gets a little more interesting. But the finance ministry and the Reserve Bank of India, which is the central bank, says that you must have 128-bit encryption. So even within the government and within certain segments of the government, nobody really knows which one to follow. And look at the current scenario today. So today, you're not just a telecom company. Many of them are also getting licenses as a payment bank. So if I were the CISO of a company, who do I follow? If I am a CISO of a telecom company which has also been given a payments bank license, should I follow the RBI? Should I follow the telecom ministry? Because following either one would be in contravention of somebody else's law. So I have no idea what's going on. The other interesting part of what's currently happening in India is there was a draft encryption policy that was put out, and it just blew up in the faces of the government. They decided that there are three categories of people who need encryption. One is, of course, the government. Second is business, and the third is citizens, so A, B, C. So, and within the government, they quickly made a distinction that whatever we are putting into this draft policy does not apply to certain sensitive government organizations who perform strategic tasks. We have no idea who those guys are. But they said, but it applies to everybody else who is sensitive and also in government. Fine. Then they said it applies to businesses and it applies to citizens. And then they made a very interesting point that any encryption by businesses or citizens has to be available as plain text for 90 days. Said, excuse me, so what is this about? So ultimately, encryption, the only time you see an encryption debate in India is only through the prism of surveillance and how much surveillance the government can do on you. So that's point number one. The second unfortunate aspect of all this is there is no public consultation or multi-stakeholder discussions on any of this. So everything that Amy just pointed out and everything that Matt, you just spoke about, and how it impacts businesses, how it, I mean, forget about human rights. Human rights is not a great subject anymore these days. It's become a little old-fashioned. But at least when you, even if you were to look at it from a business perspective, it just doesn't make any sense anymore. So as a result, you're in a strange, as I said, somewhere between the trial and somewhere between catch-22, because you don't know the inherent contradictions leaves you completely in a strange situation. But one quick suggestion that, you know, telecom companies could look at, while you're dealing with local laws, try and look at the Evidence Act of those countries. Most people only look at, say, if you're a telecom company, you only look at the telecom, or if you're a internet-based company, you only look at the internet laws. Look at the Evidence Act. Why I suggest the Evidence Act is that in some ways this may actually help you do business in those countries is that if you look at the Evidence Act and see under what circumstances authorized legal interception material can be introduced as evidence in a court of law, you might suddenly be able to find lots of clauses which, through which you can push back against demands. And the second is start supporting studies to try and find out how much of this intercepted material actually ends up in a court of law. Because if it's not ending up in a court of law, then you have a huge problem. I'll just give you one final example. Like in India, you have, it's like a federation. It's a federated government. So you have the central government and you have the state governments, and state law and order as per the constitution is a state subject. Just at the central level, the number of wiretaps allowed every year is something like 100,000. And Mishi is sitting here, she's the ED of SFLC. They have done an excellent study on this. And I also filed a right to information, and under that act, the government declared that they do about 100,000 wiretaps in a year, which means that one gentleman or lady who is the interior secretary has to sign 300 requests every day. So imagine, apparently he or she doesn't have any other time but to sign all those requests. But the point is, none of that is showing up in courts. So where is all that going? And this is just at the central level. So if you could start looking at some of those, you'll get a fair idea of where the encryption debate is going.
Very good. Thank you, Saket. Fascinating. And you will have some time later on to talk more about, in more detail about the report about going dark. But I think what we can see is that this is clearly, it's a global issue. It has different expressions in different countries and in different legal traditions and so forth, but the issues are the same, it seems. And so where the discussion stands seems to be law enforcement wants to be able to access this encrypted communication, and against that we have these economic arguments that this would undermine commerce and communications. We have the privacy arguments that this is undermines fundamental rights in a serious way. So how do we, so we might say law enforcement is asking the wrong question. So what questions should they be asking, do you think?
Hello. So I think there's this different conversation that people are having because law enforcement is saying, is this possible? And everybody else, it's actually kind of law enforcement against the world, is saying, is this possible to do securely? And the answer to those questions is different, it seems, because it is possible. It's absolutely possible to build in a backdoor, to build in a vulnerability, to ensure that every person's data at any point in time is possibly turned over to law enforcement. We have not yet found out a way to do that that doesn't make people massively insecure. And I think that's the number one point in response to this. I think the second one, for me quickly, is that we need to get past this conversation. As I said, it's been going on for decades. This is not the first, nor will it probably be the last time we'll hear a lot of these talking points. The conversation I would really like to have, and I would like to see people able to devote time and resources to, is assuming strong encryption, what comes next? And how do we move on into a world where law enforcement can get what they need and not everything, and people can be secure, and we can have strong encryption, and what does that world look like? Because we're only getting more and more data on the internet. We're only becoming more and more connected. And if we don't start having that conversation, I think we're going to be light years behind where we should be.
Maybe one small comment. A backdoor is possible, but you can't force people to use it. So for mass usage, the average user will use it. But those that actually are really motivated to hide stuff, I think they will use dedicated open source solutions. They may be even hire hackers, and they will use solutions without a backdoor. So I think that's the main point to keep in mind, that you're never going to achieve that goal anyway. I think it's too late for that, and crypto can be abused. I mean, ransomware is another way where you can say cryptographers created crypto for the good of humanity, but then it's now being abused to encrypt your files. I think we have to accept that, we have to live with that. I think with law enforcement, the conversation should be about metadata. I think law enforcement has way easier job today than they had 20 or 30 years ago, because every criminal has a phone, and even if they're very careful what they say on the phone, they still use it. The government can get to the telcos access where the phone was. The phones know where they are because they see the Wi-Fi. There is lots of metadata, and I think police investigations are way easier than they were. Maybe it's hard for local police who don't have the know-how and the resources, but I think at least everything which is done by national police forces or by intelligence agencies is way easier than it ever has been, because we all wear personal surveillance devices with us. And so we never hear them about this. And this is my biggest complaint about all these things, is that they never come with facts to the table. I've been to dozens of panels in the Snowden revelations, and there is never somebody from intelligence agencies or government who knows about these technologies and is willing to speak about them today. They don't want to speak about face recognition. They don't want to speak about tracing MAC addresses to a city. They don't speak about their technologies. And so how can you have a debate, as a technologist at least, if the other side doesn't want to show what technologies they have?
So just quickly for me, I absolutely hear and feel Amy's plea for the debate to move on. I don't think it's going to. I think this is with us for a while yet. And, you know, as I said in my introduction, the fine minds in this room and others can and should be playing an active role in trying to find a way forward. Just one addition, and following on from your question, Jens, about what law enforcement should be asking. There are multiple paradoxes in this whole debate. And one of them is that intelligence agencies and law enforcement bodies also have a statutory duty to protect critical national infrastructure as part of their job. And one of the best ways to protect critical national infrastructure is strong encryption. So wherever you turn in any aspect of this debate, you will find a counter argument against a strong argument, which doesn't help at all, but it's one of the reasons why I say the debate is probably not going to come to a close.
Thank you. Are there questions from the audience? Please identify yourself. Do we have roaming phones?
Should we take a couple of questions?
Yes, let's do that.
Hi, my name is Paul Gaskell. I'm from the British Foreign Office. I just thought I'd bring a couple of thoughts from a government viewpoint. So I'm a policy guy. I'm not a technology guy. And I think that's one of the problems that we've got, is that we don't have a proper dialogue between policy people and technology people. And I think that's what we really need to have in this space. I think that's been a problem to date. I don't agree that you have to have a balance between privacy and security, or maybe better call it consumer security and sort of public security. I think that through well-designed legislation, democracies can create legal frameworks and investigatory powers that do both, that protect both consumer security, privacy, and protect the public from the threats that are out there. And certainly when I talk to law enforcement people, when I talk to security and intelligence agents people, they tell me that this is a real problem. This isn't a made-up problem. It is a real problem. And metadata, you know, isn't the answer yet. And, you know, the danger is that we go further down the road of what we call equipment interference, hacking. I'm not sure necessarily that's any more acceptable. So we need to sort of, there needs to be a genuine discussion about what the alternatives, what we can actually do. Just on encryption, first of all, the UK government does not want to ban encryption, does not want to weaken encryption, does not want to ban end-to-end encryption. We recognize it's fundamental to the digital economy. I think there is a very specific issue around end-to-end encryption and its misuse by a very small minority of users though, who do use those systems for the pursuit of serious crime, online child exploitation, terrorism, things that all of us in this room realize, you know, these are bad things and we need to sort of try and, we need to try and tackle them. And what we want is a serious conversation about how we do this. Just sort of saying, look, it's too, you know, this is impossible, we can't do it, you know, we just don't think that's a good enough answer. We feel we need to have that conversation. And certainly, I'm a policy guy, as I said, but, you know, I listen to people like Robert Hannigan, who's the director of GCHQ. He gave a good speech last year and said, actually, you know, there may well be things we can do in the technological space, but we just need to have a proper conversation about it. Not every technical solution is a backdoor. As I said, we don't want to weaken encryption, but we do think there needs to be a proper and serious conversation soon. Thank you.
I think as Alexander Hanfield, Privacy Africa, I think as Amy said, we need to move the discussion on. It's a pointless discussion. People will always communicate in secret. Criminals will always find ways to communicate in secret, whether they're using technological means or whether they're sending smoke signals or meeting in dark alleys under hoods. We're never going to overcome this problem. We have to accept as a society that there are criminal elements in society and they will find ways to communicate in the dark. And trying to make everybody else unsafe in order to deal with a problem that you can never deal with simply is absurd. It makes no sense whatsoever.
Before we take the next question, a quick comment here.
So I absolutely understand that. I think all of us absolutely understand that. The point that I was trying to make earlier is, as I say, don't underestimate the wave that's rising of political and public concern. And the gentleman here was really flagging that. And that's not to say that anyone has an alternative answer, but it is a real factor now in public policy, this concern about the tiny minority of people who use these incredibly important technologies that for everyone else are absolutely vital to our daily lives. So I completely understand the sentiment that says it is what it is, move the debate on, it's a pointless debate. I understand that, but actually that's not what's happening in large parts of society. People are becoming more anxious, not less anxious, about the very small numbers of people that are using these things against us.
So I actually, as the human rights person up here, I realize I'm about to say something that you probably wouldn't expect me to say. I don't think these two positions are inconsistent. In fact, what I heard you both say is we need to move on with the conversation. Because as you said, I will concede that there is a problem here. Crime has always been a problem. I don't think it's a new problem. I don't think it's an encryption problem. I think we need to be able to investigate actual crime. Period. I would like to talk about how to do that, assuming strong encryption, assuming end-to-end encryption, which I think is what both of you have said. Let's talk about the next step, which I think is incredibly, incredibly important. What I worry that we're doing, though, is we're having a conversation to solve a 20-year-ago problem, which is that people don't know how to use technology and we can still get to the criminals if we just undermine the technology that's available to them. And what they're going to do is you're going to make, if you move forward with this conversation, everybody is going to be insecure, except for the very rich, or the very well-resourced, or the very technically inclined, which is gonna create almost a new class system based on how much technical knowledge you have to be able to protect yourself. And you know, the first people standing in line to be able to go to the computer courses at that point are going to be the criminals and terrorists.
There is one group out there, the very criminals that you're trying to stop in the first place.
Okay.
So, yes. To the points that you made, let's look at what happened with the Privacy International case. I mean, they won the case, the court said that anybody whose emails have been intercepted, they should be informed, etc. And the government went on appealing and did not reveal that information. So the basic question here is that while you want to have a dialogue between the government and civil society, the government wants to know everything about civil society and citizens, but is refusing to show anything about what they are doing. Yeah. My basic question is, where is the data that proves what you're saying? Where is it backing you up? There is nothing that backs you up. In India, forget about terrorism, even for tax evasion, phones and emails can be put under interception. And that's absurd, because if traditional methods of investigation cannot track this, then no amount of interception will actually be able to do something. And if you have to make a case, then please show us the data. And out of, say, 3 million people, if you're going to show only one person whose data has helped you stop a terrorist attack, that's just not enough. And unless and until you don't show that data, we refuse to accept what the governments are saying.
Sorry, the worry is that we end up in a place that is far less transparent, that's far less controlled, that has far less oversight even than we have today, and makes everyone far less secure. And that's more likely to happen unless there is, you know, intelligent, constant engagement, including by the people in this room, with the decision makers about the way forward. So I absolutely agree with your sentiment, but my plea to all of you is again, this sense in the wider public that something isn't right here is not going to go away. Yeah. We have to do something that addresses that.
But I'm afraid, as a technologist, I think we're still having the wrong debate. I think it's fascinating to discuss what we would do if everything was securely encrypted. I think that's a fascinating discussion. I'm happy to have it, but we should be aware that this is something which is at least 5 to 10 years away. Today, there is no secure end-to-end encryption for the masses. Governments have been effective. One question to Vodafone is, when will my 5G calls be encrypted end-to-end, right? Vodafone is very worried about the security of their customers, but if you speak on the phone, they decrypt everything. That's what the standard says, as soon as you hit the fixed network. So I think it's a legal obligation, yeah. But so you see that, in fact, we still don't have secure phone conversations. So and still we're having somehow governments who have shown massive ways, legal ways in the license, but also hacking, but also intercepting HTTPS and whatever. We have seen in the Snowden documents a whole array of techniques they've been using to intercept our communications, yet somehow by raising the debate after every terrorist attack, we all discuss what to do to put backdoors in encryption. It's the wrong debate. What to do to get secure encryption in the first place in hands of the people. That's the debate we should be having today.
Thank you. We're going to have two more questions. You've been waiting for a while, Lorenzo.
Yes. Lorenzo Pupillo from Center for Policy Studies. Now, I want just to understand better, to push the debate forward. What is the level of debate among law enforcement, policymakers on alternative way to bypass encryption, like lawful hacking or metadata? And the second question is the idea of escrow key 2.0, is this something reasonable or like to balance this approach?
Shall I answer quickly? Unfortunately, that's not only not the only barrier, it's actually probably the smallest barrier.
Thanks.
Yeah. The point I said earlier about the lack of legal certainty, that's a pretty big issue. You know, the fact that no telecoms operator today can be sure that it is complying with its legal obligations in carrying secure end-to-end encrypted traffic, which means that in theory, any operator tomorrow could have a knock on the door and be in a world of trouble, that's a pretty big barrier. Yeah, I mean, educating people how to stay safe is part of our job. We do a lot of that already. Building our networks as much as we possibly can to make them secure is absolutely central to our job. Otherwise, we lose our customers' trust and they leave us. But the lack of clarity around the law, and also the lack of clarity, to be honest, about the wider public policy and political debate about where all this should go, is a bigger barrier.
Thank you. There was a...
There are three questions.
Lorenzo was waiting for an answer on key escrow 2.0. Was that your question?
Trusted intermediary concept, yeah.
Well, I think there is just no solution that will work. I mean, maybe one government can set it up, but what international conversations? Will then two governments have access? So I think a key escrow system is a backdoor, and I think it's very difficult to make it work in international context. And I think some governments have been putting backdoors. There is the Juniper case, and in fact, Juniper had a backdoor in their routers, and it turns out somebody, some other nation, hacked this backdoor and made it their own. So something cryptographers have been warning for 10 years actually now has happened. And so I think this kind of magic solution, where you do it in an all-transparent way, where there is just a central party, is just not workable. And I think the first challenge to put forward is international. Which nation gets access to this backdoor? That's one thing. And the second thing is that those who targets will not use this technology. So in fact, the technology will actually cost a lot of money and will not actually help you to find the guys you want to find.
Okay, I know there are more questions waiting, but I did want to give the opportunity to Saiqed to talk about your Going Dark report and give us some conclusions in addition to what you've already said. If you can talk for about 5 minutes or so, would that be okay?
Or maybe we could take questions and continue the conversation. I mean, that's okay. I mean.
Okay. That's fine. Okay, let's take more questions.
The report's available online, so people could...
Okay.
It's very good, yeah. By the way, you've not seen. It's really interesting.
Hi, Daniel Dukovnik, independent software engineer. First, a quick comment and a question. First, I'm actually not convinced that keeping this debate going continuously is not a bad thing. We have the strong crypto, we know how to make end-to-end encrypted software, and if the debate keeps going, and let's say in a couple of years, the governments of the world just get tired and say, all right, we're gonna have a back door. Well, everybody's just gonna keep using the versions before they had the back door. So keeping the conversation going, even if it doesn't seem to get anywhere, it seems like it's maybe not the end of the world. And the question that I had, unrelated, is there any work in academic or corporate research about how to make the metadata that is being leaked everywhere less available, less identifying?
Question, I think.
Maybe I can take the second question, and maybe May wants to answer the first one about the debate. I think, of course, there is Tor, and you're all aware of this. Tor does hide your IP address. Of course, Tor was never designed to resist an organization with the power of the NSA or GCHQ. It's not for against global attackers, but of course, we can all use more Tor, and the more Tor is being used, the more secure it becomes. Tor is for real-time traffic, so it's actually, this puts some limitations on the level of security you can get. There is now an increasing interest in mixed networks, which is some old idea of David Chaum, and there were some first implementations available. For example, my team is in a project called Panoramics, which intend to make available an open source code for a mixed network, and organizations can run their own, which actually would work for email or maybe chat messages. And so I think there is a unique interest, and that would hide the metadata. Where there is almost, and I think both things, Tor is deployed, something like a mixed network could be deployed. What I see as the main challenge is location data. Location data, there is like 100 papers on how to protect location data. There is zero deployment. Because it's extremely difficult, you have to hide both at the network layer, MAC address, IP address. Also, your phone sees many wireless networks, so the SSIDs of wireless networks are visible, that allows for location. And of course, there is zero taste from operators or internet providers or the Googles or whatever to actually offer such a service. Right, today, if you want location privacy, you have to root your phone and start lying about GPS, start lying about, I mean, you have to hack more or less everything the phone sees. That's possible, but it's only available to the happy few, the 1% of the best hackers can do this. But I think it's definitely a challenge for society because we need this too.
Just to pick up on your first point, in a sense, one of our worries is a licensed telecoms operator, because you know we're in the middle of everything that we're talking about. Whatever happens, because we are on the ground providing services under a license that requires us to comply with local laws wherever we are, if a couple of years from now there's a whole series of kind of fragmented outcomes that involve things happening on our network that we are not allowed to be aware of, over which we have no control, over which there is virtually no form of oversight, there is no form of assessment, audit, whatever, that's a bad place to be. That's a problem. And one of the reasons why, come back to my conversation with Brett months ago, and I proposed this session, is, you know, we and others like us want this debate to happen in the form it's happening so that more and more people are engaged in thinking about, well, what is a good outcome? What is a good outcome? Because potentially what you're talking about is the bad outcome.
So at the beginning of last year in California, there was a court case about a terrorist using an iPhone and the FBI wanting to get into it that most people here probably have heard about. That case at a district court level, I believe, and I have no hard evidence to back myself up, but I have heard from other people that they believe this as well, had more amicus briefs submitted than any other case in the United States at a district court level ever before. In fact, we submitted the first one along with our friends at Wicker, and they thought about naming us amicus because they had never had to figure out how to name multiple amicus in a case before. And so we ended up being, don't tell Brett, don't tell my boss. We ended up being, yeah, I know. We ended up being listed as defendants in that case because that was the only thing they had available. They just didn't have a system for it. We were, in fact, amicus. So the problem is that that was able to happen because right now people are paying attention and there's money and there's resources and there are people who can write those briefs and who can make that happen. The reason that the debate has been as long drawn out as it is because law enforcement are betting that at some point that won't happen. And they really took a bet on that with the San Bernardino case. They thought that they had found the case where the facts and the law were so much on their side that people couldn't possibly argue against them. The longer this debate keeps happening, the more likely that is to happen, and the more likely we are to have the terrorist attack or the crime or the situation where we don't win. And that is the future I worry about if we keep drawing this out. And I would like to rather move forward to productive things that we can do than risk having huge backdoors that could fall out of our technology by continuing to fight a fight that should have been long over.
Can I just add another perspective to what you asked? I think taking the metadata argument is a bad argument. And the reason I'm saying this is because ultimately, what is the problem? The problem is not that you're generating a lot of metadata. The problem is how governments are taking that metadata and taking away your freedoms. So the point is that we shouldn't so much concentrate on how much to hide, because the moment you start getting into that framework as an argument that I need to hide so much, you are ending up ceding space from other freedoms which are actually constitutionally guaranteed to you. Why should you cede that space? And also, let us look at the reality of the digital economy. Today, you need metadata for many of our businesses, for many of our services. So if you want to book a flight, you need location data and so on and so forth. Why should you give up those freedoms? The basic question that the government needs to answer is this, that every time, say, a terrorist attack takes place, what is the terrorist trying to challenge? Your way of life, your freedoms. So the answer to that is not less freedom, it's more freedom and more economy. That's the debate we should have.
I like the response, but I still want to point out that, of course, with your government, you can have a dialogue. It turns out that there is also other governments that collect your metadata. And so in that sense, it may make sense to hide it, because you just don't trust other governments, even if you would manage to convince your government that they shouldn't do it.
I mean, no dispute there, but you can see after the Snowden revelations, a whole lot of countries have started pushing back, which is why a lot of private companies have become much more sensitive to what their customers are. So, you know, this give and take thing is, but I think the other thing in this encryption debate we should look at is there is a whole surveillance industry which is actually pushing this forward. And they work in the shadows, they don't come out in the open, they don't sit on panels for sure. And they are in many ways undermining all these freedoms that we have. So start identifying them, start targeting them. Believe me, you will win a lot of battles.
This is about transparency and independent oversight. Ultimately, that's the real battle, to my mind. It's when the state takes an action against a citizen in the name of the citizen should know that the state is doing it. It's kind of that fundamental.
Thank you. Next question, please.
Hi, my name is Andrew Bridges. I'm a lawyer at Fenwick & West in Silicon Valley. I wanted to build on something Amy said earlier, just a detail about the Apple iPhone case. I filed one of the many amicus briefs in the case supporting Apple. One thing that people don't know, which I think was shocking, is that the government, remember that this was 2 months after the attack. The government had the iPhone. Apple was not fleeing the jurisdiction. The government got a same-day order from the magistrate that ordered Apple to provide the hack without waiting to hear from Apple in opposition. The order was in effect, and the government was threatening Apple with contempt of court. Even though the court gave Apple several days to respond, the government took the position that Apple was in contempt before it even had a chance to respond. And the idea that the government has to act so quickly, I think, suggests that the government wanted to halt effective opposition, to have it even examined properly by a magistrate hearing both sides of the story. And we need to learn a lesson from this. People need to be ready and able to swing into action and to fight things on 3 hours' notice, even when there is no emergency. That tells you something, I think, about how the government viewed the legitimacy of the debate. The government brought this, and the magistrate approved it in a way to forestall debate. I'd like to go to one other point, if I may, and that is the point that the public is going to rise up because of the threats that we face. And I do agree a little bit with the person earlier who talked about the messaging around this. The worst disaster the United States suffered was the attacks of 2001. The same number of people die each year in New York City from cigarettes as died in that terrorist attack. We don't have Fox News interrupting a broadcast to report that Jane Smith died in Brooklyn this afternoon caused by cigarettes. There is a lot of messaging there. We see, I think, a rising tide of anger at the level of surveillance.
That's true,
Zoe. And we need to balance that anger at the surveillance with the fear of the attacks.
Yep.
And the point is, this surveillance is itself a harm and will cause damages because the back doors that enable the surveillance are the same back doors that threaten our safety. Thank you.
Thank you.
Maybe I should stop. Okay, my name is Mishi Chaudhry. I was going to go to 2 points. What happened after the Snowden revelations, maybe I should start. What happened after the Snowden revelations was that whatever the governments actually thought was illegal, they went ahead and made it they went ahead and made illegal stuff legal. In my own jurisdiction, there are a lot of things which are allowed legally for surveillance. You pointed out about telecom operators operating under licenses, and many of these license terms also have a gag order when some information is required and that doesn't come out. So most often in our social contract, what we are observing is that the citizenry is supposed to be completely transparent because of all the surveillance, and the government is going darker and darker in terms of what they release to us. And then they give us this carrot of judicial oversight, which is a long drawn process. And we also saw how FISA court was used in the US and what happened. So this disingenuous conversation where it's always binary about privacy versus security, terrorism versus protection, et cetera. As long as they're going to keep putting up that as the straw man, we're not going to have any real discussions. And because that's going to happen, and that wave is coming, and you're right, because when the narrative is such, we're not gonna get over it by just dismissing it. And that's why I wanna come to the techie in the room's point. That's our only resistance is an open source encryption. The more we teach ourselves to encrypt, the more we actually make it resistant for these people who are not going to have a conversation which is genuine. If you don't show us what you have, how do we actually tell you whether that works or not? And having backdoors or whatever, as long as it's open source, we can at least have that kind of resistance. So if the panel can just talk a little about, when we know that's the pushback coming,
yeah,
then as society and government and companies are part of that society, what is it that we do now?
So one of the things that everyone needs to do is push for greater government transparency. Okay, so you'll notice in all of my remarks, because this is live streaming on the record, I will never name an individual country in anything I say, because in many of the countries in which we operate, we cannot talk publicly about these things linked to that country. So that's an example of the kind of challenges that my colleagues have to deal with day in, day out, which many of you in the room and indeed on the panel understand very well. And ultimately, I think that's actually a bigger root of the problem than the technology. The fact that people do not understand what is being done in their name that can have the effect of restricting their freedom of expression, their ability to freely associate, their ability to run their lives in the way they see fit. And that's why, by the way, after Snowden, in fact, even before Snowden, we were working on it, we published our transparency report, our first transparency report, which, for those of you not seen it, has a very, very large front end, which is all about everything you ever needed to know about what it's like to be a licensed telecommunications operator and deal with these complexities on the ground, when you get a warrant, when you're dealing with direct access, when you're dealing with all the stuff that we have to deal with, and then a country-by-country section at the back and a legal annex, where country-by-country, we essentially say, in this country, we can't tell you anything. End. That's it. But we can tell you what the law is, and the law says blah, which says the law says we can't tell you anything. That's got to change. That's really the big meta debate that has to be resolved here, which is very simply, when governments take actions to protect their citizens, they should explain to citizens what those actions are. Everywhere.
Other remarks?
I mean, you pointed to the NSA and to the FISA court and to a lot of things happening in the US. And I've spent many, 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 many days and in fact nights of my life fighting against those things. I think my only addition is that I would encourage people to think of this as a global issue. If you continually point to the NSA when you deal with encryption, I think we're missing huge portions of the puzzle. In fact, we're only concentrating on a small piece. And I think I'm echoing a bit about what Matt said, but it's more about state and local and domestic surveillance agencies, police agencies, basically the entire cadre of people who want to get access to data from the government side, as well as the people, bad actors who want to get access to data as well. And so it's such a huge threat to data. That if we only look at that tiny piece of it, we're missing the forest for the trees, I think.
I do think, of course, that Snowden leaked some stuff and some other nations said, interesting, we should do this too. I think they have an example. So I think it's clearly that more nations started doing similar stuff as something was predicted and I think eventually happened. I mean, we have only spoken about government, of course. Also, companies do a lot of surveillance and there is, of course, this kind of collusion that governments are stopped. At least in Europe, governments are to stop companies from collecting this data, but on the other hand, they actually go and get it at the companies. So the governments now have a huge conflict of interest. The more data companies collect, the more actually governments have access to. And so I think it's, at a global level, I think everybody who has access to data and power because of data should be fully transparent about what they have and what they do. And citizens should actually have privacy. But I think we've turned things around, and today, I mean, citizens are fully transparent, and those who actually have power are not fully transparent or are not transparent at all. I think it's about changing the rules, and I think also about stop collecting data, just forbidding it to collect data. I think that's the only solution.
I would just state specifically to what societies can do now. I would suggest that what is the government's argument today? That they say that theft is a real and clear and pleasant danger. So please keep your houses unlocked so that we can prevent you from theft. That's essentially the argument that the government is trying to give you. The idea should be to try and put more and more focus back on the government and make their accountability higher. And that accountability higher does not mean that because you failed to prevent a terrorist attack, therefore you have failed. That is not the argument. The argument is you have failed because you have essentially failed to protect the freedoms of certain groups of people. Therefore, you have to ensure that more and more of those freedoms can be protected, and it can be done through due process only which through which you will be able to push back on some of these regimes.
Okay. I have a suggestion. So, Amy, you talked about the debate ought to be framed as given strong end-to-end encryption, what then? Mm-hmm. And I suppose that leads to government hacking discussions and what are permissible practices for law enforcement and others in order to gain access to either stored or in-flight information. Do you have some thoughts on that and how you would like that to go?
I do. I really do. We published a paper last year called "A Human Rights Response to Government Hacking." And we published that because we realized that around the world that this activity was being engaged in more and more frequently with less and less conversation. And in fact, in the US, we actually allowed our Congress to implicitly approve a procedural mechanism to allow the US government to conduct hacking operations last year without ever having publicly debated whether they should be doing this substantively or whether the law permits it in the first place, which we really thought was a backward way of handling this conversation. So what we said in the paper, there were a couple different conclusions we reached. The first one is that we think that government hacking poses significant human rights threats that you see with no other type of surveillance. And we try to lay out the technical problems, the legal problems, the rights-based problems when you start to engage in government hacking. And we said outright that this is not something that we think should be taking place. It's just too risky. Practically speaking, though, if you end the conversation there, you've only had half a conversation because the governments are doing it anyway. So we went a little bit further and said, if you're going to do it, is there any way to be consistent with human rights? And we laid out what we thought were, really we cheated. We called them 10 safeguards, but there's a lot of safeguards in each safeguard to protect human rights within this activity. And I think that's it's really important to be engaging in that conversation and pushing toward a framework if this activity is going to happen anyway. I also believe this is going to potentially be the most divisive issue in civil society globally over the next few years. Because some groups are going to say, absolutely not, never, and some groups are going to say, sure, and somewhere in the middle, we're just going to go to war with one another. Which will be unfortunate, and I hope we can start having that conversation now to avoid that. I will say, as soon as I get off this panel, we're submitting comments to the Italian government because a member of parliament has put forward a law in Italy on government hacking. And I was prepared to hate it because that's what I do. And I read through it, and I was like, wait a second, considering it's a law on government hacking, which, again, we're against as a concept, this is actually incredibly good. And they've really thought through a lot of the problems and the things that we saw were issues, like requiring code databases and having audits and removing the malware at the end of an operation, which is really wonderful. And so having conversations like that with what could be written into law positively, as opposed to countries like the US that are doing this with no protections whatsoever, which can't be good and has global impact, I think is the wrong way. You can't just ignore it and stick your head in the ground and think it'll go away.
Thank you. Very interesting. We're coming towards the end of the session. If there's a final question in the audience, now is the time. There's one down there.
I have seen a lot of things being touched in this this whole discussion, but I would like to ask, when it comes to strong encryption, we have talked about backdoors and governments doing their role, etc. And Mr. Bach-Prenil just pointed out that there is another aspect, that there is no such thing as bulletproof encryption. There's some sort of backdoor, there's some sort of sneaky way to get into the stuff. But my question is, on the other side, the security community is continuously taking efforts to make encryption better and more better and strong and more stronger. But as a basic user, what I have seen is things are becoming more complicated to use. The usage complexity is getting higher and higher. And the more complex a solution is to use, the less people will use it. So what will you think, or what's your viewpoint on making encryption easy to use as well as strong enough to sort of stand these sort of threats of state hacking and other agencies?
Excellent. A statement and a question, but a good one. If the panel can take a crack at it and sort of roll into that your final remarks, that would be great.
I don't think there is an immediate correlation between usability and strength. I think we've learned over time, and I think WhatsApp and Skype and so on are actually very easy to use, and it's completely transparent to users. I mean, there was recently a debate because of an article in The Guardian that Signal, for example, is slightly harder to use than WhatsApp, because if you lose your phone in the case of Signal, you lose all your past conversation and all your contacts, and WhatsApp has a backup, of course, which has security implications. So I think there is always this trade-off, but I think at the basic level of encryption, whether your encryption is very strong or not, should not be impacting usability too much. And I do think we've made progress in making encryption more usable. But of course, there is still a way to go. For example, for email, there is still no usable solution, amazingly, after 25 years. But I guess we keep working on this.
I think that's exactly right. I would add that I want companies to be able to devote 100% of the resources they have for security toward better security. And not have to be mandated to only spend 90% because that other 10% they have to design a product that fails sometimes, but not always, which is what these mandates are kind of requiring. Like, have very, very strong security that fails when we tell it to. And so that is, I think, a problem. I think we have better security if we devote resources to it. My colleague would tell you, he walked out of here earlier, that I don't internet well. And by that, I mean every time something gets more complex, I personally have a problem with it. I think the usability and the user interface problem is real and is getting more significant. We have pushed for strong security implemented by default. Apple has done that. WhatsApp is doing that. Just to introduce the other piece of that conversation is that there is actually a security trade-off sometimes. And so, for example, we may get more phishing attacks if we're not able to scan email for phishing attacks because it's end-to-end encrypted, which means people have to be much more vigilant,
yeah.
And much more well-educated. And so there are two sides to this coin. It has to be usable, it has to be easy, but people also have to be willing to protect themselves in light of the increased protection from encryption.
There's a study that I'm doing currently which is based on Indians who are joining the ISIS. And it's based on what we call in our jurisdiction interrogation reports. They are documents which are not admissible in the courts of law, but you can read them and you can sort of see what kind of intelligence comes out of it. And it's throwing up some very interesting impressions so far. And the first thing that hit me was that while there is a lot of debate about CVE and these other platforms where, et cetera, most of the reports that I'm reading, they've moved on to platforms I've never even heard of. And I can't mention them because that's privileged information. So the point is that we are going about this in some ways the wrong way, because the response we are giving is that while so-called malicious malcontents are moving into better and better encryption, we are trying to prevent it by reducing the encryption of the good people who are in a majority. I mean, that's an absurd argument. So instead, what you should be looking at is how to increase and allow companies to give better and better encryption to more people, because at some point, these same malcontents will hit you because you have poor encryption. And that needs to be recognized not only by us, but also by the governments.
So just to pick up on your point about, you know, how do you make it easier for people to benefit from encryption? Part of the answer lies in the network, not just the device. So increased network intelligence and resilience and encryption at the heart of network design is a big part of that. But that's, I'm afraid, another one of my paradoxes, that the more that an operator like us focuses on keeping our customers safe at the network level by increasing resilience and increasing the range and depth of encryption that we embed within our systems,
the more we run up against the same debate, yeah, which is that we have license obligations requiring us to give access to lawful law enforcement intelligence agencies on receipt of a warrant, blah, 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 and where they want legal interception access, they want clear text legal interception access. So how do we reconcile the two? It's very, very difficult.
Thank you very much. We are at the end of this session. I just want to say that so there was a strong sentiment that this is the wrong debate to be having and we should be focusing on other things. There is just, as Matt was saying earlier, there's this, the political reality that policymakers and to a large extent the public have this concern. I think we have to realize that when we also filed in the San Bernardino case, piles and piles of briefs filed, but the opinion polls were pretty 50-50 between Apple and FBI. And you know, last week, or Amber Rudd in the UK is now meeting with the communications company and the tech companies, not with the car rental companies or with the kitchen knife companies, right? So this is just not, this is not going to go away. But I think we have contributed a lot to it today. I've learned a lot for sure. And again, thanks to our great panelists, and thanks for your participation.